Hello students, welcome to today's class. As we know, all of us, you and me, are very curious individuals. In fact, human beings are curious. And whenever something happens around us, the first question is, why did it happen or how did it happen? From the time we are children, we ask these questions. Now, what do these questions mean? What are we trying to achieve by asking these questions? These questions are nothing but our attempts to determine causation. We want to know what caused something what we saw or what was the cause behind something we experienced. Now, similar questions of curiosity are also faced by psychological researchers. They also want to know what are the causes behind mental disorders. Why are certain mental illnesses caused? Now, the earliest causation views of mental disorders were essentially biological. And in fact, it was this biological causation that laid the foundation for the development of an empirical and research discipline of psychology. Initially, researchers believed that mental illnesses were almost exclusively biologically caused. Now, later researchers understood that biological causes were not the only reason for mental disorders. There were also psychological causes for mental disorders. Further research, especially in these centuries, has revealed that there are not only biological and psychological causes for mental disorders, but also social and cultural causes. So there has been an evolution of the causation models across the years. First, from the biological model, we came to a biopsychological model. And from the biopsychological model, today we have the biopsychosocial model, which recognizes the importance of biological, psychological, as well as sociocultural factors as elements causing mental illness. In this class today, we are going to focus on two of these causation factors. One is psychological causes and the other is sociocultural causes. Now, there are a number of common psychological causes for mental illness. Let us have a look at some of these. Perhaps the most common, the most basic and the most primary psychological factor causing mental disorders is personality factors. Now, what is personality? Personality, as we all know, is the unique and relatively stable traits and dispositions that we all possess. There are two major factors in this definition. Firstly, these traits and dispositions are unique, which means that it differentiates us, it differentiates you from me, it differentiates us from others. And second, they are relatively stable, which means that we are likely to behave in unique ways across situations, which in other words means that a situation which affects one person may not affect the other. And even if it affects both persons, it will not affect both of them in the same way. So it is but natural that we transfer this understanding to the field of stress and other psychological disorders. Not all people will react in the same way to stress. A person who has a more stress-prone personality will react in more pathological ways to even a normal stressor, whereas others may not. The result is that certain personality factors may predispose a person towards mental disorders. For instance, we know the Big Five model of personality developed by Costa and Macri. Their Big Five factors of openness to experience, agreeableness, extraversion, conscientiousness, and neuroticism, which many researchers believe reflect almost all facets of the human personality. Now, there is one factor in this neuroticism which is characterized by anxiety, insecurity, excessive guilt, and excessive self-consciousness. And all of these are personality factors which may predispose an individual towards mental disorder. And the second is pessimism. Pessimism is another personality factor, a predisposition to look at the negative outcome of life events, which can also predispose an individual towards pathological behavior. Similarly, people having an external locus of control, as per the Julian Rotter's locus of control theory, tend to believe that everything in their life is predetermined, and so they have no choice to control their life, and hence this personality dimension can be a potent cause for mental disorders and pathological behavior. Similarly, people with type A personality patterns characterized by a lot of aggression, competition, irritability, and restlessness, or a perfectionist personality pattern, especially perfectionist concerns and obsessive concern even over normal things, can lead to pathological behavior patterns and advanced forms of psychopathology. Another psychological factor which can lead to mental disorders is severe psychological trauma. The sources of severe psychological trauma can be many, ranging from violence, conflicts, uncertainty, insecurity, the loss of loved ones such as parents, siblings, caregivers, and others, the loss of relationships, abuse in many forms, emotional, physical, or sexual, and so on. And to what extent the trauma affects the individual depends on the individual's age, the type of trauma that is, as also the length to which the individual is exposed to the trauma, as also to the extent to which his close family and others are affected by that. One thing we need to remember here is that psychological trauma, especially of the severe kind, when it occurs in childhood, is extremely debilitating because children do not have resources as adults to deal with trauma. And it not only affects their childhood development, but also has long-standing effects into adolescence and adulthood. Neglect is another psychological cause of mental disorders and essentially occurs in most cases in childhood. It is a form of maltreatment where the child is not given much needed assistance, guidance, and supervision from parents and others. Now, parents who neglect their children in most cases have themselves been neglected children, and so they do not know what it is to take care of the child, or possibly they are so emotionally disturbed by their own childhood neglect that they cannot take care of the child effectively. And we should actually distinguish between neglect and other forms of abuse, because to remember very precisely, abuse is a more direct and intentional form of maltreatment aimed at inflicting harm or injury. Another potential psychological cause of mental disorders is emotional detachment. You may have seen many people who find it difficult to relate to others on an emotional basis. They find it difficult to share their feelings with others, and they also find it difficult to understand the feelings of others and empathize with them. This may be due to their own personality factors, but also another reason for this is the fact that they in their life may have experienced some kind of traumatic event which caused them a lot of emotional turmoil and upheaval. So as a result, they have become emotionally detached in an attempt to protect themselves from the kind of emotional trauma that involves the experience of emotions. But just because they deny their emotions doesn't mean that they do not have emotions. This kind of emotional repression and an over-rationalization and logical approach to life, which may not be possible in every way, leads to a buildup of anxiety and depression and a thorough possibility of mental disorders. Also, since they have a poor ability to relate to others, they may also lose out on vital social support in stressful circumstances. Now, the last psychological cause, a major cause for mental disorders we'll be dealing with, is loss. Loss, as we know, is traumatic. Whether it is the loss of your loved one or someone significant to you by death or otherwise, whether it is the loss of a relationship, whether it is physical loss such as economic loss, academic loss, or in fact the loss of anything that you value, loss can be and is traumatic. And secondly, loss is most traumatic for children, especially when it involves loss of parents and caregivers, because it creates an atmosphere of insecurity which they cannot actually overcome very easily because they are still children. They don't have the resources we adults have. There are two other psychological sources of mental disorder. One is frustration. It is close to loss, closely associated, because loss also involves an inability to gain what you want. Frustration also involves obstacles in achieving what you desire. And the greater the frustration, and the more you need that, and the more you desire the goal which is being frustrated, the greater are the chances of mental disorder. Similar to frustration is conflict. Conflict is also a primary source of mental disorder, whether it is conflict with an outsider, and more so when it is conflict with someone close to you, someone significant to you. And in fact, the most potent cause of mental disorder is your own internal conflicts. Conflicts between your own values, your own beliefs, your own actions. There are when gaps are created between what you believe and what you do, what you want and what you have. These kind of conflicts within yourself can be one of the most primary causes of mental ailments. Now that we have had a brief overview of psychological causal factors of mental disorders, we'll be moving on into the socio-cultural causes of mental disorders. As we have seen earlier, theorists have recognized recently and recognized in enormous ways that social and cultural factors can be potent sources of psychopathology. Now, by the beginning of the 20th century, there were two fields, one was sociology and the other was anthropology, that were developing independently, and independently they were making rapid movement and development towards understanding the social and cultural influences and bases of human development and personality. Now, there were a number of socio-cultural theorists, for instance, notable among them are Ruth Benedict, Abraham Kadiner, Margaret Mead and Franz Boas. If we can remember Margaret Mead, she is a sociocultural theorist we students of psychology often refer to. She actually made a very pioneering and a very systematic study of adolescent development in remote cultures. And after spending years in that culture, she put forward her book Coming of Age in Samoa, which is a very interesting study. Now, coming back to the sociocultural theory, what these theorists said was that the development of the individual personality has a lot of influence from factors such as the individual's family, the other social groups that the individual is a part of, as also the larger society, including its cultural bases, its values, its traditions, its attitudes, its beliefs. So the individual is not just a single entity. Yes, he is a single entity who is brought together by a number of socio-cultural forces. Now, socio-cultural studies also revealed that there was significant relationships between certain societal conditions and socio-cultural factors and the simultaneous occurrence of mental disorders. Moreover, when these social conditions changed, the pattern of mental disorders and the intensity of their occurrence also changed. Now, all of us who have studied biology know that we receive a genetic inheritance from our parents. And what does this genetic inheritance comprise of? It comprises of thousands of years of biological evolution, right from microorganisms to what we are today. Now, similar to this genetic inheritance, we also have a socio-cultural inheritance. Now, what is our socio-cultural inheritance? Our socio-cultural inheritance is what we have received as a result of a long process of socio-cultural evolution, right from earliest times to our modern age today. Now, each socio-cultural group has its own cultural patterns, has its own traditions, values and beliefs which it teaches its younger generation. And the more limited the beliefs and views are and the more consistent the teaching of these patterns are to the younger generation, the more similar members of those cultures are. But this is not always the case. For instance, if we take certain multicultural countries like the US, there are a number of ethnicities, races and people from different parts of the world who congregate there and become a part of the American culture. So a child brought up in that culture is exposed to a large number of cultural views and practices. And so individual differences in children in such multicultural cultures will be of course greater. Now, the subgroups of any culture consist of a number of subgroups: gender groups, age groups, religious groups, regional groups, language groups, even caste groups if we consider the Indian scenario. And each of these groups puts certain social roles on the individual, roles which the individual has to fulfill. And since the individual is almost simultaneously the member of several groups, many a time the roles come into conflict. His role in one group comes into conflict with his role in another group. And such conflict is often the basis of mental disorders. Now that we have seen that sociocultural factors actually are potent causes for psychopathology, we'll be overviewing a few of the more important sociocultural factors. The first is a low socioeconomic status. Research has revealed that there is a significant inverse correlation between the socioeconomic status and the level of mental disorders, which means that the lower the socioeconomic status, the higher are the chances of mental disorders. Now, this inverse correlation, though significant, is not similarly significant for all kinds of mental disorders. For instance, it is highly significant for antisocial personality disorder. If we look at the statistics, the incidence of antisocial personality disorder is almost 3 times as more in people from a lower socioeconomic status as compared to those from a normal socioeconomic status. On the other hand, this significance is quite lower for disorders such as depressive disorders, which is only 1.5 times more in people from a lower socioeconomic status. Now, why do people from a lower socioeconomic status stand a greater chance of developing mental illness? The reasons are simple. A lower socioeconomic status involves a number of stressors, a greater number of stressors, because life is uncertain. The fulfillment of basic needs is uncertain, the fulfillment of healthcare and education needs is uncertain, and the quality of life is lower. So naturally, people have a greater amount of stress to deal with. Also, they have lesser resources to deal with the stress. So naturally, they are more vulnerable to mental illnesses. Now, coming to children from lower socioeconomic families, research shows that yes, children from lower socioeconomic families are also very much affected, and they can be affected in two ways. Firstly, by the direct lack of resources they need, the direct lack of education, healthcare, or even basic necessities. And secondly, is from the indirect emotional upheaval and trauma they face, because they know that the conditions in the family, the financial conditions are not good. They know that everything is uncertain. They don't know what will happen tomorrow. And they know their parents are tense, and the parents may also react in ways such as they may be anxious, they may be depressed, and this passes on to the child. And hence, naturally, we can see that children from a lower socioeconomic background tend to show a greater degree of anxiety, depression, and aggression even at a preschool age. They show more acting out behaviors, and they show a greater degree of affiliation to deviant peers and antisocial activity. Also, research shows that children from lower socioeconomic backgrounds have a lower IQ, and this holds true at least in the first 5 years of life. Of course, there are exceptional cases where children from such backgrounds also tend to do exceptionally well. But one thing that may be there is that such children who do well have some kind of a support system in terms of a supportive family or caring siblings, which actually makes up for the emotional tension that involves a lack of financial resources. Now, those who are already suffering from mental disorders due to sociocultural or whatever reasons, they stand a greater chance of slipping down the economic ladder and going into the lower socioeconomic classes. Firstly, because mental disorders may involve a loss of employment, it may involve increased medical costs for the family, and even when the person is recovering, he may not necessarily get gainful employment because there is a lot of stigma, prejudice, and discrimination associated. So all of these factors create a vicious cycle, in which, because of the mental disorder, the person suffers from financial hardships, and because of financial hardships, he cannot actually regain his level of mental health because he may not be able to access mental health care and other facilities, and again the cycle goes on and on. Now, in addition to socioeconomic status, researchers have also tried to analyze the importance of employment, specifically unemployment in this context, as a causal factor for mental disorders. Now, we see that since the 1970s, the world economy has seen a lot of upheaval, it has seen a lot of uncertainty, and there is always there have been frequent recessions like we saw around a year back. And during these recessions, a number of people are laid off from their jobs, companies downsize, and a number of people turn up jobless. Research studies reveal that unemployment involves a number of other facets, apart from the loss of employment. For instance, of course, it involves financial hardships, and in addition to that, it naturally involves anxiety, it involves depression, and more importantly, it involves a sense of self-de-evaluation where the person loses his self-esteem. He loses his ability to be an earning member of his family or a society, or the ability to take care of his family, which can be extremely depressing. And even it is seen that wives of men who are unemployed show greater levels of aggression, anxiety and depression, which shows that it has a familial effect. It is not only the person being affected, it is the wife, the children, the entire family being affected. And apart from the adverse emotional consequences on children, similar to what happens in a lower socioeconomic status, children in this scenario of unemployment also stand the chance of abuse, because surprisingly research reveals that fathers who are unemployed are more likely to abuse their own children, both physically, emotionally and sexually, which can, as we know, lead to extremely and unimaginable traumatic consequences. Now, apart from this scenario of unemployment, the focus on economic crisis has also focused on underemployment since the 1990s. Now, underemployment is a scenario most probably limited to the upper middle class, where because of corporate restructuring and downsizing and such other practices, individuals are forced to do jobs which are lower than what their skills and capacities and talents ask for, because they cannot get jobs on par with their skills and talents, and because they have to continue with their lives, they take up any kind of jobs which require lower skills and which provide lesser satisfaction and lesser monetary rewards. This results in a lot of frustration and a lot of loss in self-esteem. Research has also revealed that when you compare unemployment and underemployment, the level of depression and anxiety and traumatic consequences are almost equal, which means that underemployment is almost as big a problem as unemployment. When unemployment or underemployment are a consequence of mental disorder, again a vicious cycle begins. Because either this may be because the person is incapable of handling a job because of his mental condition, or because there are factors in the society such as stigma and prejudice which prevent him from getting economically rehabilitated. Whatever the reason, the result is unemployment, the result is underemployment, and of course, frustration, conflicts, and anxiety. Now, prejudice and discrimination is another socio-cultural causal factor which is a very potent cause for mental illnesses and psychopathology. Even with all the progress that we have achieved, even in our modern society, there is a lot of prejudice and discrimination on the basis of race, caste, class, ethnicity, region, religion, language, and so on. Even though a number of efforts have been made to reduce these gaps, the fact remains that in most cases, people tend to prefer those from their own subcategories or people who belong to their own classes, and the result is an isolation from and a misunderstanding of those who are different from them, who belong to different social classes. An isolation which leads to prejudice and discrimination in various areas such as housing, occupation, social status and the like. Now, one major area of discrimination and prejudice is gender, an area which has received a lot of recognition but where still enough has not yet been done. Many researchers have revealed that women tend to show a greater amount of anxiety, distress and depression as compared to men, and the main reason for this is the kind of passive, dependent and powerless roles that women are assigned to in the society. Even in the workplace, for those who are career women, there are two kinds of problems. One problem is access discrimination, where women actually do not get to access jobs they deserve because they are women. The second is treatment discrimination, where women may actually have an access to jobs, but they are not treated in the workplace on par with men. They are not given the same opportunities for career development, the same pay and the same kind of treatment. Sexual harassment is another well-known problem in the workplace which adds to this kind of mental conflict. Again, the woman is required to play a very complex role as a full-time housewife, as a full-time mother, as a full-time career person. And this kind of confusion among traditional roles and modern roles and the inability to resolve all this to put forward a perfect front creates a lot of turmoil for the woman, and this becomes a potent cause of mental ailment. We all know that we live in a society which is changing and which is uncertain, a level of uncertainty which perhaps none of our forefathers experienced. Everything relating to us, our education, our jobs, our families, values, cultures, traditions, everything goes on changing. And adjusting to such a kind of changing environment naturally involves a lot of stress. Moreover, again, there are man-made problems such as terrorism, such as the loss of natural resources, increasing overcrowding, increasing pollution, and even the most technologically advanced countries today know that their technological advancement or the wealth that they have cannot ensure a perfectly peaceful future. So this kind of knowledge, this kind of confusion and depression that collectively engulfs the human race again becomes a potent socio-cultural source for mental ailment. Another socio-cultural factor we should concentrate on as a causal factor for mental disorder is urban stressors such as violence and homelessness. Especially in many societies, especially the Afro-Asian societies and the Afro-American societies, we can see that there is a culture of violence and gang wars that happens even among adolescents right from childhood. And around 3.5 million people are losing lives worldwide every year because of such kind of violence. Apart from this, there is also the scenario of domestic violence, which most often affects women and children, taking a toll not only on their physical health, on their physical productivity, but also on their emotional lives totally. Another severe sociocultural problem is homelessness. Most of the homeless, in fact, are those who are mentally ill. But when homelessness results out of violence or poverty, it puts such a lot of stress on the person that even a healthy person becoming homeless stands a great risk of developing a mental disorder. Now, the development of the socio-cultural viewpoint has had a far-reaching impact on our understanding of mental ailments. It has led our focus from solely on the individual to factors surrounding the individual, his family, other groups, his society as a whole. And it has also led us to concentrate on changing the social environment of the individual so as to prevent and better treat mental disorders, a factor which is most evident in the development of a new discipline called community psychology. But still, in spite of the strong evidence of the socio-cultural correlates of mental disorder, many theorists still do not take a cultural view. They believe that any system of classification or treatment that is suitable for people from one culture will also suit people from all other cultures, which is a very erroneous view. In recent times, there has been an increasing advocacy of the need to include cultural factors in the understanding of mental disorders. It has also led to a movement that seeks an incorporation of a separate axis on the DSM, which is the main classification system we use, which recognizes the cultural significance of a disorder and the cultural correlates and influences of a disorder. Although we have not been able to achieve a separate axis as such, the DSM of course has made rooms for certain changes. For instance, it has included an appendix where ways are suggested in which the cultural factors for a disorder should be considered and how the diagnosis should be put forward. Also, the clinician is encouraged to understand a person's cultural identity, the possible cultural factors that may lead to or influence the disorder, as also the cultural factors that may influence the patient-clinician relationship. And finally, the DSM also provides a glossary for culture-bound syndromes or certain disorders which are particularly found in certain cultures. So this, as we can see, is quite an improvement, quite a recognition of the importance of cultural factors. In this lesson, we can see how the biological viewpoint has given way or has expanded in a way to include the psychological and socio-cultural causal viewpoints of mental disorders, so that now we have a complete picture of how mental disorders are caused. And thus, in a way, our curiosity regarding mental disorders is on a way towards a more complete satisfaction.